every time, though.
I would like to personally welcome you to Man Hour Out the Dark.
Say that there.
Where I bring you the host, Mike, Buck, and Cone.
You know we're coming to the stage. Sports talk
than what you about to hear right here.
I second that.
Go. You know that it's us when we talking about sports. Giving you facts on the field to the core. Tune in, we need the support. 1 hour too short, then listen some more. On all your stations, not dropping no music. Stripes like Adidas, but Nike just do it. Down 4 and 4th, we go for the win. Michael, 2 seconds, we taking it in. Buck, Mike, and Combs, you know what's going on. Man, now we're out the dark, no LA, we a big spark. No 4th and inches, won't cut short. Got the best talking, it's all sports. Buzzing more than buzzer beaters. We coming live, all 3 speakers, go.
And what is up, everybody? Michael Buckheiser here with the Man Hour. Head over to manhourradio.com. Check out the new website. We have merchandise, blogs, and, of course, the members-only tab as well. So I let Combs handle the reins last night. And quite frankly, I got some what does for all three of you. So let's welcome Brandon Combs to the show. Brandon, what's going on, man?
Man Hour Nation, welcome to the best damn sports radio show on the planet. Man Hour Nation. Buck and the boys messing with me backstage before the show. I had to move my camera 17 freaking times. These guys are driving me nuts. Buck is about to lose a race by 17 yards after he gets a 10-yard head start. Wyatt's still going to be in the starting position that he was in before when they finished crossing their finish line. I can't wait for this show, man. I'm going to go off on the Baseball Hall of Fame.
What you don't realize is that Wyatt is a Division I athlete with a professional voice. So, therefore, yes. He has all the makings of a true athlete right
exactly.
here.
Exactly.
He's a Division I clown.
Exactly. No. Division athlete right here. I bench like, 400, squat probably 7, deadlift probably around 4.
And then he is
not meaning pounds. He's meaning 400 hamburgers. He's like,
That's bogus.
Yeah. So speaking of hamburgers, we had a hamburger tonight for supper. Is there nothing better than a good hamburger fresh off the grill? Like, let's be honest, guys.
Oh, we had steak tonight, man. Steak fresh off the grill is pretty good, too.
Have you ever had Five Guys burgers and fries?
I don't like their burgers. I do like their fries.
Their fries are amazing. I think their burgers are great, too, man.
Their Five Guys burgers are good.
I'm not saying they're so bad by any means, but their fries are definitely trumped the burgers 100%. So why did your cleaning lady make that steak for you?
Your maid?
Yeah, my dad did. My dad is an excellent cook.
MJ is still the goat.
Agreed.
What about the 40 points that LeBron James dropped last night? Does that not have any warrant?
Well, you see, Buck, these guys are never going to realize that there's other basketball players on planet Earth, okay? Because they are so stuck. Because they're so stuck believing that MJ is the GOAT, they refuse to admit they're wrong, and they will stick on that as hard as they can.
No, I listen to other guys who played the game who all say that Jordan is the GOAT. Maybe a couple will say LeBron, but not very many.
Oh, Scottie Pippen said he's the GOAT?
Scottie Pippen's a moron, and he rode Jordan's coattails to 6 titles.
You guys are really messing with my transitions, because Wyatt said people suck, basically. And I had a nice transition set up to bring Hoffy in, and now you guys all mess that up because you guys want to keep talking about LeBron.
People suck.
Hoffy sucks.
Speaking of people sucking, the baseball writers.
The baseball writers
did not vote anybody into the Hall of Fame. So Hoffy, do I see a Buccaneers jersey on there?
Yeah,
just for Wyatt.
He's that New England Patriots fan who is now a Buccaneers fan.
But
Buck, I know you ain't talking, Mister. I'm a Green Bay Packer fan. As soon as the Kansas City Chiefs get off the air,
My wife is a Green Bay Packers fan. I'm not a Green Bay Packers fan by any means.
Cindy's a smart lady. She knows what's up.
I've got a couple texts I can screenshot of you saying "Go Pack, go."
Yeah. I mean, I was rooting for the Packers over the Bucks 100%.
Exactly.
If you're going to root for one guy or the other, right? Like at the end of the day.
You root for Aaron Rodgers.
So, Hoffy, the real question is, turn around. Does it say Brady on the back or does it say Chris Sims?
Shoot, you busted me.
Oh, if he turned around and that said Sims, I would lose it.
So, guys, we are going to switch things. We're going to switch things up a little bit here. Hoffy is our baseball lackey, And speaking of the baseball lackeys last night, the writers did not vote anybody into the Hall of Fame. Curt Schilling was the closest at 71.1%, basically was 16 votes away from getting into the Hall of Fame. And I believe, was it Roger Clemens or Curt Schilling? Somebody came on the Facebook and said, basically, take me off the ballot for 2022. I don't care anymore. So, Hoffy, you are the guest of honor, per se, or, we just say that to make you feel good about yourself. But what are your thoughts about the whole Baseball Hall of Fame not voting anybody in?
I mean, I don't know if Combs can keep it together, so we might as well let him start on this one. I think he's boiling at the bits to go, so we might as well let him start with his
I guess we can let the other ginger go.
Look, I don't know what it is about the baseball writers that make them think that they can play God. And it drives me absolutely positively insane that they think that they can draw a moral compass line somewhere in the sand and say, these guys get in, but these guys don't. We're not going to ever vote the steroid era guys in, but you broke that rule because you let Jeff Bagwell in. You voted Pudge Rodriguez in, who was also implicated in steroids. You let all these other guys. You're going to vote David Ortiz in next year, first ballot guaranteed, because if you don't, you're a moron, because David Ortiz belongs in. But
does he, though?
Absolutely.
Oh,
David
yeah.
David Ortiz is the best DH, most clutch hitter I've ever seen in my life. But
Big
Barry
Poppy.
Bonds is the greatest player of all time. And to sit there and say that a guy who had seven MVPs, a guy who has hit more home runs than anybody, a guy who was phenomenal outfielder for a vast majority of his career, and then you're going to not even let a guy who's won seven Cy Youngs in, but you knew during this whole time when they were playing, you knew what was going on. Baseball knew what was going on. The baseball writers knew what was going on. It was obvious to everybody that watches the game. And now, because now you want to draw more, you let Jeff Bagwell in, you let Pudge Rodriguez in, you're going to let David Ortiz in. And why? Because those guys were likable. Those guys were guys that treated the media differently than what Roger Clemens did, differently than Curt Schilling did, differently than Barry Bonds did. And that is crap. So this is, just call it what it is. This is the Baseball Writers Association of America. This is their good old boys club. This is not the Baseball Hall of Fame. This is the good old boys club. And until Major League Baseball tells the baseball writers to go pound sand and takes over the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame, it is a sham. Because to not let a guy like Barry Bonds into the Hall of Fame because you don't like him, you are a puss. 62% of the voters got it right. The other 38% are complete freaking morons.
So with that being said, Coffee, I'm going to let you chime in because you are our baseball lackey. But let's be flat out honest, guys. Like, when you just have writers vote for the Hall of Fame anyways, it is a kind of a good old boys club anyways. Because if you look back in history, there are some snubs that have been left off the first ballot Hall of Fame.
Pete Rose. Really...
What's that?
Pete Rose.
Yeah, I mean, he is still banned from baseball, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, correct.
Pete Rose is a different story.
Yeah, but still, like, when you allow writers to vote on things, like, of course I'm going to vote for my friend over somebody else, right? Mm-hmm. With that being said, Wyatt, bring that comment back up. Because this was going to be one of my what does, but Roy's only in his power.
Guys, I mentioned that last night too.
Listen, guys. Steroids do not give you instant strength. And steroids help with recovery. You still have to work your damn ass off mm-hmm. to get those muscles. You still have to work your ass off seeing the ball and hitting the ball. The only thing steroids do is help the recovery process. So yes, in return, you can say it helps with like power. You
I think Buck is defending his roid rage right now possibly did some roids back in the day.
Steroids get the most. steroids get the worst rap ever. Name. Give me one thing bad that steroids do besides make you go bald or go hairy or something just like that. Changes your voice. The fact is that steroids probably can cure cancer if you would like allow it to.
I mean, and that's the thing. That's the thing with Bonds that kills me. This guy struck out 100 times once in his career, and that was his rookie year. This guy absolutely positively was the most feared hitter in the game for much of his career. And to sit there and say, oh, steroids, steroids, stop. We pay these guys hundreds of millions of dollars to entertain us. So if they want to take steroids to further entertain us to make more money, by all means, do steroids. Do what you got to do. Entertain us. Go play the game.
So the fun fact is that steroids do not shrink your nuts. They actually make your penis grow because your penis is a muscle. So therefore,
I'm about to do some steroids.
It basically gives the impression that your balls shrink. So therefore, Drew, sorry to burst your bubble there. Steroids do not shrink your nuts because your nuts basically stay the same size. Actually, they get bigger throughout your whole life. Mine are hanging down to my knees right now. But
lying ass.
God.
But Hoffy.
I love being young, man, not having these issues. My dad always makes jokes about the day that he sits down on the toilet and they drop in the cold water, man. Like,
that's the worst, man. Oh. Let's be flat honest. Oh. Nothing wakes you up more at 5:30 in the morning.
I would scream at the top of my lungs.
Oh, hello. Hoffy.
I'd scream at the top of my lungs, man.
Hey, guys. Hey, help me.
I'm telling you, man. These writers, just like Combs, were never good enough at any sport. So to feel important in life, they, took up journalism. But, I mean, we have, you got to be in the, writing about baseball for 10 years, I think is what it is, in order to be cast a vote. So we have Hoshi Shimbam, a sports paper in Japan. What does that have to do with the United States, the Major League Baseball? I mean, they should be voting on Japanese Hall of Fame players, not, you got Kyodo News, non-corporate newspaper. What does that have to do with sports? What do they know about sports? And we talked on, Jeff Bagwell and people that, are in with steroids, people that haven't got in because of steroids. How about Kenny Lofton? Just because the guy played for 11 different teams, we're going to keep him out. I mean, the guy still put up numbers that are very similar with, some of the better defensive, players. I mean, he was still stealing bases into his 30s. So, I mean, I think
what about
Cal
Ripken?
Yeah,
there's no way you played all them games and didn't have something to help you through the everyday issues and the aches and pains of the regular season. You played that many games in a row and you didn't have anything to help you through your minor injuries?
How about this? Ken Griffey Jr. was basically injury free till, kind of the tail end of his career, right? Like
when they started testing for steroids.
Exactly. And people say that he never used because he was skinny, I'm like, guys, steroids don't add size to you, so I have to put the work in the gym. Steroids help with recovery, and it basically the only thing that steroids do is increase your blood vessels, increase the blood flow, so therefore it helps the recovery process. That's all it does.
Well, they were using HGH, which is different. It's a human growth hormone, which is it does enhance your ability to gain muscle. It does enhance your ability to get strong. But you're right. You do still have to do the work. These guys were still above anybody else. There is no way you're telling me that the steroids are the reason why Roger Clemens was a 7-time Cy Young. There's no reason why you're telling me that steroids is the reason why Barry Bonds won 9 gold gloves.
The only devil's advocate I have on those stats is that they wouldn't be able to produce those stats because they wouldn't be on the field to recover from injuries faster. That is the only fight I have with this issue.
We got football players that are accused of murder, been tried for murder, et cetera. They're in the Hall of Fame. So, I mean, what's the big deal with
you can't quit, right?
Dude, you don't even have to go to the NFL. Look at Ty Cobb in Major League Baseball. Mm-hmm. That man is a known racist. It is known that on his off days, he would go down to the Bronx and shoot blacks for target practice. That was his off day ritual. He's in the Hall of Fame. But we draw the moral compass at Barry Bonds using steroids.
Shoeless Jackson.
Combs, I believe we have talked about this. I think when the Man Hour first started was Man Hour After Dark you basically want a separate wing in the Hall of Fame for the steroid era guys, right?
No. I'm saying if that's what you want to do to get them in, I'm fine with it. But they need to be in the Hall of Fame. There is no reason you inducted Bud Selig. who was the commissioner of the
best
steroid era.
Ever. Best commissioner what? Ever. Juice what those the, balls, like, baby.
I don't understand what, the, like, where their moral compass is. The only thing that I could tell is that these three big names that they're keeping out, these guys who absolutely positively deserve to be in the Hall of Fame.
Thanks, McKay.
Don't get me wrong, Schilling's probably the most borderline of the three. But the other two definitely belong in. The only difference between them and the guys that you have let in are you actually like the guys that you let in. They were mm-hmm. actually nice to you when they were in. And the reason why Barry Bonds was so standoffish with the media is because they saw the way that he saw the way the media treated his father, and he didn't trust nobody.
Right. So before we head to our first hidden. Before we head to our first break here, guys, let's go ahead and go around the horn real quick. I'm going to name off three names. Tell me if they deserve to be in the Hall of Fame or not. Curt Schilling, Hoffy, do they deserve to be in a Hall of Fame?
I got to say yes. I mean, he led two different teams to World Series. I mean, he was, you know, a number two starter for both of those teams. And, you know, he would have been a number one if he wasn't behind, you know, Randy Johnson in Arizona and such. So, yeah, I got to go with, you know, yes.
Combs.
Probably one of the best postseason pitchers of all time. You know, had a couple bad seasons. I think this 05 season with Boston, he had like a 6 ERA or something like that. So there are some numbers that are borderline for me, but I would certainly voted him in for sure.
Wyatt?
Yes, yeah, great pitcher.
Barry Bonds, Hoffy.
Yeah, I mean, he's one of the – I think he is the best hitter of all time. I mean, I guess you can, you know, talk about Babe Ruth, Ted Williams, et cetera, but yeah. – All-around baseball player. I mean, he's right there, minus the fact that Babe Ruth also pitched. So, you know,
yeah.
He's there. Absolutely.
Brett Boone said that his grandfather, yeah. who watched Ted Williams play, would never admit anybody was better than Ted Williams. And then a couple days before he passed, he actually admitted to Brett that Barry Bonds was the greatest hitter of all time. And Brett mm-hmm. Boone said, well, that's probably why he died 2 days later, because he knew I was going to give him crap the rest of his life. So
it wasn't the
Barry
shot,
Bonds.
Right?
Barry Bonds should have been in the day he should have been given the Jordan treatment, and they should have just let him in the day he retired.
Wyatt, what about you?
Yeah, Barry Bonds is a home run king. All right, like Hoffy said, he's the greatest person to ever pick up a bat. Pretty much, it's ridiculous the numbers he put up. Roids or not, the numbers he put up are ridiculous. I mean, literally the home run king. I don't know how you could not put someone who's hit more home runs than anyone else in MLB history. I don't know how somebody that like that could not make it into the Hall of Fame. So yeah, absolutely.
I actually think when he was at Pittsburgh, he was a Hall of Famer player there too. So mm-hmm. that was before he got on juice.
Whoa.
And went to
what?
There you go. Why
is your grandma saying? Why haven't I heard about this yet? Why is this the first you're hearing of it?
I didn't know this.
So right, why? Whoever Ted Williams is in relation to you is a piece of shit. I'll tell you the story as to why, but you know, we'll leave that for another time.
Hey, guys, Wyatt, we are going to head really to our Williams. We gotta hang out sometime and talk.
To head to our first break, guys. We're way over time right now. Hoffy's going to start joining us every Monday and Wednesday on the second hour of the show to some baseball talk. Hoffy, are you ready to break some heat? Because quite frankly, man, you know, you've been kind of siding with Combs a lot here in the chat on the youtube.com/manhour, and
because Combs is smart.
It's kind of starting to boil up a little bit, man. So
Combs is getting all his knowledge from me. Don't let him kid you.
Oh,
he's piggybacking off my shit. Oh,
all right, there you go, guys. Hoffy, the man, the myth, the legend himself, the baseball lackey. Thanks for joining us, Hoffy. We'll see you next Wednesday because we got Super Bowl talk. Actually, no, what have you on Monday? Monday, Wednesday,
oh,
next
man.
Week.
All right. If you guys are lucky, I'll join you.
All right, guys. We'll
see
be
you, Hoffy.
All right, guys, we're going to head to our first break here on the Man Hour, guys. Head over to manhourradio.com. If you miss any part of the show whatsoever, you can find the podcast directly right after the show. Guys, we'll be right back after this on the Man Hour.
Close my mind.
And welcome back to the Man Hour, guys. Michael Buckhouse with Brandon Combs and Wyatt Williams, the men themselves, guys. That was a heated little topic that we had about baseball. Let me go ahead and unmute you guys. That's my bad. I forgot to unmute you guys. Well, welcome back. Welcome back. Welcome back. Combs, did your blood pressure get a little high? Did you take the blood pressure pill today?
Dude, my blood pressure always gets high when we're talking about the Baseball Writers Association of America. And look, this is one of the things that I've always wanted to do. I've always wanted to be a part of the Baseball Writers. I've always wanted to be a part of voting for the Hall of Fame. And I've always wanted to change the way the process is done. But at this point, with the way that they're going and the things that they're still doing, man, I don't want any part of them. It's a clown show right now. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, so, I mean, really all you got to do is write for 10 years, right?
Yeah, you got to be a part of, you got to be on a baseball beat for 10 years.
So what you're saying is they can join the Man Hour Blog Nation, write for Major League Baseball for 10 years, and then they can become...
I think it has to be an accredited piece of work. I'm not sure how that works.
Best damn sports show on the planet, son.
I agree. And I'm smarter than 38% of the people that voted, so...
All right, so speaking of smarter than 38% of the people that voted, it is time to talk some Super Bowl, and we have seen some, basically, guys, I feel like this is the Super Bowl matchup that everybody wanted. They wanted the old goat versus the young goat. Like, apparently, did you guys know a young, like a baby goat is called a kid?
It's called a kid.
Yeah, so the goat versus the kid.
True story, the other day, Buck, when you asked me to do the post for the day because you were busy and all that, I did it, and I was like, all right, what can I do that is trendy? I was like, how about a goat versus a kid? Because a kid is a goat, Mahomes is the kid. I thought right. I was smart. I put that up there, and then, like, I kid you not, I had not seen that yet, and then, like, 10 minutes later, ESPN Sports Center pops up, and it's like, the goat versus I'm like, all right.
Yeah. I actually think I heard that on the after the Chiefs won versus the Bills. Like, I think Tony Romo said that. I think it was. Is Tony Romo really? not the smartest person ever right now? I mean, like, at what point do people start knocking on his door to become a head coach or a GM?
Never.
Really?
He's a good.
I don't think a head coach. I know he really enjoys broadcasting. While he was still in the league, I've watched a lot of Jim Nance. I actually had a Zoom call with Jim Nance one time. But I saw something with he was talking about how Tony had been super interested in broadcasting. He went to a couple of the Masters and watched Jim call the Masters and stuff. So I think he really is into broadcasting, but I could possibly see an offensive coordinator maybe. He's a really smart football mind. He just wasn't insanely good at playing the game is his problem.
People say he is arguably the greatest Cowboys quarterback of, like, all time.
No.
Really?
Troy Aikman is.
Just because he won Super Bowls?
I mean, I think you have to be considered the greatest at something, you have to make a run at the Super Bowl.
And he made about as many runs as Aaron Rodgers, right?
Yeah.
Well, one. but I mean, Tony Romo was never anything in the playoffs. I mean, he never did anything. Yeah, he had a couple of 12-4 teams.
They won one game in the playoffs, and they won one game.
He never won one. I mean, if he did, he won, like, one. That's it.
Yeah.
So he just wasn't successful in the playoffs.
Yeah.
Where if you look at Troy Aikman, I mean, the Cowboys were the winningest team in all of the 90s, the entire decade. They won more Super Bowls than any other team. And I hate the Cowboys. I mean, but I'll admit it right here.
Team, though, too, right?
Well, I mean, they did, but, I mean, their quarterback was the leader of that team. Yes, Michael Irvin was good. Yes, Emmitt Smith. Yes, they're Hall of Famers. But, I mean, Troy was a beast at QB. He was ridiculous.
You did not name half the team. Like, they had, like... Three or four Hall of Famers on the offensive line. You had Deion Sanders on there. Like, that team was stacked, bro. Like,
it was.
And Emmitt Smith was, I mean, that's probably maybe the sixth best running back of all time.
Really?
Yeah. Come on, man. Wyatt could have ran through those holes.
Oh, man. Sheesh.
That sucks.
So, apparently, guys, Wyatt is not related to Ted Williams.
Damn false alarm, boys.
But
speaking of
being related, guys, when you guys were doing Two Lies and a Truth last night, was Steve Young related to Vince Young?
No.
Oh, no? Okay. I was really hoping, like, that would be cool. Let's go ahead and talk about the GOAT versus the kid, the Super Bowl matchup, Super Bowl 50 here in about 10 days, I believe it is. Guys, is this the best Super Bowl matchup of quarterbacks that we have ever seen? Combs.
I don't know about the best matchup of quarterbacks. We are very much a prisoner of the times, I guess I would say. I would say that because it's happening right now, people are going to talk about how this is the best matchup of quarterbacks of all time and this and that. When you look back on it 10 years from now, is it possible that that's that? But I just can't give Patrick Mahomes that billing just yet. I think Patrick Mahomes is great, and I've said it before. I think he's Aaron Rodgers, Tom Brady, and Lamar Jackson all wrapped up into one quarterback. I think he is a great quarterback, and he has the ability to be the greatest of all time. If, for some reason, he had a career-ending injury next season, God forbid, would he go down as one of the greatest quarterbacks of all time? I think he would go down as somebody who could have been. I don't think he goes down as one of the greatest of all time. But so for right now, I would say no, it's not the greatest quarterback matchup of all time. I mean, we've had some really good quarterback matchups in the past that are, you know, heads and tails above this.
Name one.
I mean,
Manning and Breeze.
Yeah, Manning and Breeze was a good one.
That would be the only one I would say was better. I mean,
You had Brady versus Breeze. You had
they didn't play.
I thought they played in one of Brady's.
I don't think so. Brady beat the Eagles. Brady beat who else? He beat Matt Ryan.
Brady and Eli Manning.
That was a good one, but that,
you know,
yeah,
and Eli came out on top twice, so. I'm pretty sure if I go back and look, I mean, who did Marino play? Didn't Marino make it to a Super Bowl?
He didn't win one, but I
know he
might have
made
it
2-1. I think maybe he lost to Montana or something like that. Like they back then, like I mean, the quarterback. Then you look back when you had Starr versus Johnny Unitas, that type of stuff. I mean. Those are quarterback matchups that right now I would say were better than what it is now. But again,
yeah, Marino and Montana played. Another one that I forgot to mention was Elway and Favre.
Yeah.
That's another good one too, Elway and Favre. But I would say this is probably going to be the second best ever because Tom Brady is the GOAT. In my book, this might be a little bit of recency bias. I mean, probably not, but I love Patrick Mahomes. I think he is an incredible athlete. I think this is the game where he can seriously take a run at being the greatest of all time. I mean, that is such a stretch at this point for anybody to try and dethrone Tom Brady because he doesn't lose. Like, it's just, if he wins this year, he will be 7-10. In the Super Bowl, 70%. Okay, most quarterbacks don't even have a 70% win in the Nick Foles versus Brady, Brian. Yes, jeez. Brady. Yeah. The first one though, they played originally. That was Brady's first Super Bowl, right?
Yeah,
I think Brady's first win in a Super Bowl was against. Was that against the Eagles or was it?
No, he did beat the Eagles. He beat Donovan McNabb and the Eagles in one of the Super Bowls, but it wasn't
I thought so. First.
Yeah, that was the 2004 Super Bowl.
And then you look at, I mean, at this moment, if Patrick Mahomes retired at this exact moment, I think he is a top five quarterback of all time. For what he's done in this short amount of a time, for what he is, I mean, it's kind of like Aaron Rodgers was the lead up to this. Aaron Rodgers was that gunslinger, and then everybody always said nobody will ever be Aaron Rodgers again. You know, Aaron Rodgers' knack is that he can't win a Super Bowl. I agree. Believe me, I know it firsthand. But then we get this Mahomes guy. I mean, and he makes Aaron Rodgers look like he was nothing. Not actually, but yeah. I mean, he is seriously going to be, if not the GOAT, Patrick Mahomes will finish top three without a doubt. I think what he's done already makes him top five. And just as long as he can stay healthy, Patrick Mahomes is going to win at least at minimum. Yeah. Patrick Mahomes is going to come away with 4 Super Bowls. Like, there's not a doubt in my mind on that one.
So Aaron Rodgers is like pre-cum. I mean, like if you if you stick it in there one time, you might get lucky and pop out a baby, right? But Patrick, Patrick Mahomes is the full load. You know, you get
what
get a better
happened?
Chance.
Buck, my family's watching this, man.
I am sorry to all those listening on 313 The Flash in Detroit. I'm not sure what just came out of this man's
mouth.
Like
a, is there a bleep we can like bleep him out on this?
So the question is. What makes a great quarterback matchup? Is it the team or is he actually the name of the quarterbacks that make the matchup? Because like right now I feel like the Brady versus Mahomes is the Chiefs versus the Bucks. It isn't Brady versus Mahomes. But if we are talking about, you know, a top tier quarterback when they make it to the quarterback, probably the best matchup that I remember was Kurt Warner and a young Tom Brady. Do you guys remember that Kurt Warner was like a 3 or 4 year span? They had the greatest show on turf. The Rams were popping, right? They're having a great time. So
99, right?
I believe
greatest show
so.
On turf was yeah. the 90, was 99, I think.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean that Kurt Warner versus Tom Brady. I think that was the best quarterback matchup that we had, because like looking back on it, yes, Kurt Warner, I believe Kurt Warner is a Hall of Famer if I'm not mistaken.
Yes. Yeah.
But that 5 or 6 year stretch that they had, he was amazing and came out of nowhere. I believe he was playing arena football and then came in and got it like a tryout, and you had a young Tom Brady. So I think that's the best quarterback matchup ever. Any thoughts on that?
I think kind of pulling forward on the Kurt Warner one. Kurt Warner and not Drew Brees. Oh my God, Ben Roethlisberger. That was a good one. It was Arizona Cardinals and it was the Steelers. That was a good Super Bowl. But I mean, I think every year, really. Here's the deal: to get to the Super Bowl, you pretty much have to have a good quarterback. Now, sure, we've had years where, you know, the Eagles for a chance, Nick Foles, a backup quarterback, runs a team to the league. You know, there's always situations like that, but I mean, I'm going to say 90% of the time, just to get to the Super Bowl, you have to have exceptional quarterback play. I mean, he is the general of your team. He has to be leading the way. Your quarterback can't be making mistakes. I mean, we could even look at Russell Wilson and Tom Brady. That was a good Super Bowl. Russell Wilson, Peyton Manning.
Yeah.
Even the year Cam Newton was good, the 1 year Cam Newton was good. Cam Newton and Peyton Manning wasn't bad. So I think just to get to Super Bowl, there has to be some kind of a name to your quarterback. There has to be something there, you know. There's a reason why Josh Rosen doesn't go to the Super Bowl every year, you know. So that's kind of what I'm getting at here.
He's a third string quarterback at 49ers now. I mean,
sure. While he was in Arizona,
but still, like I think he has had the shortest. Rosen has had the shortest stick in all of NFL football ever. He was what? Was he a third overall pick? I think he was. Like, he was high up there, right?
Yeah, he was super high. He went to the Cardinals.
Yeah, and then sent over to Miami, and then cut from Miami, was in the Buccaneers, and was with the 49ers, and I think he's somewhere else now. I mean,
he's with the Niners still.
I still like him, but one of the worst quarterback matchups that I remember in recent history, the Baltimore Ravens versus the San Francisco 49ers.
Kaepernick and Flacco.
Yep, Kaepernick versus Flacco. That was probably one of the worst quarterback matchups that I can remember.
Well, it was just like, it was this like unathletic quarterback who couldn't do anything but like just had a good playoff run in Joe Flacco. And then you had Colin Kaepernick who, yeah, he was a strong arm quarterback and he could throw it decently. But I mean, Colin Kaepernick on that playoff run probably ran for more yards than he did pass. I know because I remember we had a great season that year. We played them and Kaepernick comes on the field and I'm like, who is this Kaepernick guy? You know, still trying to feel him out for who he is, right? And then all of a sudden he takes off on this read option play and I see even D. Charles Woodson couldn't run him down. And I was like, wow, this is going to be a really long night. Like, I knew at that exact moment I saw Charles Woodson trailing him and he was pulling away from Charles Woodson. I was like, yeah, we're going to lose this game. They're advancing in the playoffs.
But I still think if Alex Smith would have came back and led that team, they probably would have won the Super Bowl that year. Let's be flat out honest.
So, they could have, yes. They had a good shot at it.
What's that, Combs? I didn't hear you.
I said, yeah, I don't disagree.
Yeah, so let's go ahead and move on to the next topic that we have. We spoke on Aaron Rodgers and like how his future is uncertain in like Green Bay, and he's in – he is basically trying to, like, I feel like he's trying to force his hand a little bit. But Jared Goff, he is not forcing his hand. But the general manager of the LA Rams says his future is uncertain in LA. However, if the Rams were to part ways with him one way or the other, it's a $31 million dead cap hit, meaning they have to pay that $31 no matter what. That is a third of the cap moving to next year. Guys, what is going on in L.A. with Jared Goff? Combs.
I think that they know they don't have their guy in Jared Goff. I think that they know that in Jared Goff, they need to move on. I believe that Jared Goff is basically in the same situation that Carson Wentz is in Philadelphia. It's time to move on. The organization needs to move on. He needs a change of scenery. Can he be a viable quarterback somewhere else? Sure. But if you ask me, I mean, Jared Goff is just never a guy who is going to get you anywhere past the first round of the playoffs. Jared Goff is not that type of quarterback. Huh?
He led them to the Super Bowl.
He led him to the Super Bowl because the Bears double-doinked a field goal. That's the only reason why they ended up going to that Super Bowl.
They still had to beat the Saints, right?
Yeah, but
they didn't win that year. When the Bears double-doinked the field goal, they didn't win that year. They won the year before.
They won the Super Bowl, but they went to the Super Bowl.
Yeah, look, Jared Goff, did they win the Super Bowl?
No, they didn't.
No. Jared Goff,
the Bears were playing the Eagles in the double-doink.
That guy. Yeah, I know they're playing the Bears were going to play the Rams the next week. The Eagles ended up going to play.
Oh, okay, okay. I get what you're saying. My bad.
Goff is just not that. He's never been that guy. That's a whole reason why I was not a big believer in the Rams the entire year. Now, luckily for Jared Goff and luckily for the Rams and for their fans, their defense was really damn good. And if that defense isn't really good, they lose a lot of games because Jared Goff is not that guy who's going to go out and put up 27 points or 30 points and get into a shootout. You need a defense that can hold them to under 17 points or under 20 points at least, because Jared Goff is not that guy.
Let me poke some holes in there. Like, we sat there and watched Jared Goff go toe-to-toe with Patrick Mahomes and the Kansas City Chiefs just a couple years ago. What was it, 56-53 on Monday Night Football? I mean, they can't score points? Good. Why?
There's so many weapons on that Rams offense that Jared Goff was not. All he had to do was throw an 8-yard out route, and then all of a sudden his receivers were busting and getting loose. And
you can say the same thing about Patrick Mahomes.
No, Patrick Mahomes throws a Tyreek Hill. Patrick Mahomes throws a Travis Kelce. Patrick Mahomes.
But I'm saying he can throw just 8-yard outs to the
right.
Of
but
he
can also break the pocket. He can also make things happen that Jared Goff could never do.
Wyatt, floor is yours.
Well, and that's what even like with talking about Jared Goff. I called that team bogus from the start because I didn't like Jared out of the draft. I didn't think he was the number one overall quarterback. Absolutely not. I thought Carson should have went first. And I think Carson, even though it wasn't great this year, has had more success overall as an NFL quarterback, of course. But Jared was carried. I mean, everybody forgets about it. Todd Gurley. Does anybody remember Todd Gurley that year? He was the best running back in the league. He was insane, but he busted his knees up. And that's another thing I said. You know, the guy's knees are trash. He played a terrible year in L.A., and then they shipped him out to Atlanta. So, and you mentioned that Monday Night Football game. Yes, he did have a lot of weapons about him, but something else people forget. The Chiefs, the one knock on the Chiefs at that time was their defense was trash. They didn't have Honey Badger. Who'd they have then? Who was their big DB they had?
Eric Berry was still there.
Eric Berry was there, but there was a cornerback. I don't remember who it was, but they were led by their cornerback crew on defense, and that's really all they had. They didn't have really any Ragland wasn't great that year. They didn't really have any pass rush up in Goff's face. I mean, in that game, the dude had all day to throw. That's really why he kept them in that game, and that's why they won, was because the Rams' defense was so good that Patrick Mahomes had to fight through that good defense, and it actually brought him down to the level of Jared Goff for that game, because the Rams defense was so dominant at that time with how good they were playing. I mean,
Pat Mahomes three times in that game.
Yeah, that's what they really sunk in that level. And here's the thing, even though they picked him off three times, Patrick Mahomes was still in that game because, yes, they had the three picks, but the Rams couldn't really, yes, they capitalized in the end on offense, but they should have won that game by more than what they did. That should not have been a game with the mistakes that Patrick Mahomes had made with the three picks. There was also the fumble from – who was the running back at the time? I believe that was Williams fumbled it, and then the defensive end picked it up and had the scoop six. So they really shouldn't have even been a game. The Rams should have put up more points than what they did, and the Chiefs shouldn't have put up as many as they did. But Patrick Mahomes is just so good.
So you brought up a couple things in your speech there that kind of perked my eyebrows a little bit here. You said that Carson Wentz has had a better career than Jared Goff so far, right?
Yes.
And I do, and I know we got some Eagle fans watching. Like, a guy saw Hurdle jump up in there, like in the chat. But let's look at Jared Goff's stats over just the last 4 years, because the first year he only played 7 games. But so 2017, he had a 62% completion percentage with 3,800 yards. 2018, 65% with 4,700 yards. 2019, 63% with 4,600 yards. Go ahead.
He has better weapons. What has Carson Wentz really had to throw to? Think about it. Nobody. I mean, DeSean Nelson Jackson? Aguilar, old yeah. and washed DeSean Jackson, Nelson Aguilar, who couldn't catch the ball in Philly, Arcega Whiteside, who can't stay healthy on the field, Rager, who can't stay
Alshon
healthy.
Jeffrey.
They can't. Alshon Jeffrey has been a shell of him of his former self. He has none of these guys have performed to what they were when they were in other places, or like DeSean Jackson. DeSean Jackson hasn't performed like what he did whenever he was Vic. Yeah. Nothing against him. He's just old now. Same with Alshon
Jeffrey. He's had a lot of really big, really tall wide receivers, but they're wide receivers that drop a lot of passes. That was the one knock I had on Alshon Jeffrey when he was here with the Bears, was that he would complain about, you know, he's not getting the ball enough or this.
Brandon
or that,
Marshall
he would drop
is definitely
the passes
better
when they were sending it to him. So,
I would go as far to say this: Carson Wentz on the Rams, Carson Wentz would have actually beat Tom Brady in that Super Bowl.
No.
Yes. It was 10-3. They only put up 3 points in the entire game. Carson Wentz is a much better playmaker than Jared Goff. Carson Wentz would have found a way to hit the end zone. Absolutely he would have. If he would have been healthy.
And
but that's in his knack.
So let's say that Wentz does score events versus that dominant Patriots defense that season. You still put the ball in Tom Brady's hands with his back against the wall.
But they couldn't score at all in that game either. They only put up 10 points.
You are right, but they also didn't have to. So Tom Brady wasn't cursing on the sideline saying, get your head into the game, yada, yada, yada. They were just kind of just going with the flow of the game. I mean, every game that you look at, when Tom Brady has his back against the wall, somehow, some way, he performs. And, like, I don't know what it is about him, but somehow, some way, he performs. Andy different. So Brian Pirtle says Andy Reid is a difference in the Super Bowl.
So I sent you guys a meme earlier that had a picture of Matt LaFleur on the top, and it said, 4th and goal, game on the line, and I'm kicking a field goal. And it said, 4th and goal, game on the line, threw a pass with Chad Henne.
Yep.
Like Andy Reid definitely has the bigger balls, but I will not say Andy Reid is the difference in the Super Bowl, because I've always been a big proponent of Andy Reid's clock management loses him more games than his coaching has ever won him. So he is the liability for the Chiefs, not the reason they'll win the game.
I think it's the other way around. I think Bruce Arians is going to make the mistake, because Bruce hasn't really been in these situations like Andy Reid. I mean, Andy Reid has had 4 NFC championship caliber, or he's been to the NFC championship 4 times. He's now won a Super Bowl. He's been to 2 now, I believe, maybe 3.
But be real, Wyatt, Tom Brady's coaching this game for the Bucks, not Bruce Arians.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, absolutely. He's running the playbook, but I still think there's going to be some slip in the defense that's going to give this one away, because you cannot allow anything to go. Just ask the Buffalo Bills. You cannot allow any kind of a defensive slip against this Kansas City offense, because they will burn you on it. They will burn you on it bad.
You guys are 100% correct, but we're going to take our next break. On the other side of the break, we got the world-famous What Does, brought to you by Thrive Fantasy. Head over to ThriveFantasy.com, use promo code MANHOUR, and an instant match bonus up to $50. That is ThriveFantasy.com. We'll be right back.
Uh-oh.
And welcome back to the Man Hour, guys. Every Woo! Time I see the overlay, like I chuckle a little bit inside. Shout out to BC over there for putting up. Our graphics guy is on point. I mean, I say do it. Actually, I gotta even say do it. Coleman's like, you know what, Wyatt, bite this bullet, son. Bite this bullet. Every time, guys. But, guys, awesome. We are getting ready to get into the What Does. What Does is basically a segment that, you know, we just say what is on our mind. Like, what has made us say what the for the week.
And, I've got quite a few What Does this week.
Yeah, I got quite a few, too, because I was listening to a show last night. I was just like, man, they really need a good host on there. But, you know, it like it is what it is. But we'll get to the What Does, guys, here right now. First, what the other night is going to go out to Walmart. It is not the black bag special, special again. It is their online grocery pickup, right? So last night, you know, Cindy puts in a online grocery order for it's supposed to be done between 5 and 6. I get off work at 5. I'm like, great. They shoot me email at 4:30 saying, hey, your order is ready to get picked up. So I sneak out of work a little early. I go call the 1-800 number to pick up my order. They don't answer. I was like, okay, like, you know, it is 5 o'clock. I guess there's a lot of cars here. Maybe they're busy. 22 calls later, they do not answer the phone, and I feel that they kind of gave me the FU button toward the end there. So I walk inside, and there are 15 high school kids in there doing TikTok dances. The old tickety tock 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 tick.
I was one of them.
With that being said, my what is going to go out to TikTok. TikTok, I thought you guys were going to get banned in the U.S. What happened to that? I mean, we need Trump back to ban TikTok, guys. That's the only reason why I voted for Trump was to ban TikTok, because I literally spend 3 hours of my day on TikTok. TikTok, you get the what the of the day.
All right, so my first what the other day, Buck, we are never going to get our clothing line into a Walmart if you keep giving them your what does, by the way.
Anyway. Stop sucking.
My first what the of the night is going out to a reporter in Colorado, and I'll leave her name out of this. But I saw on a news segment out of this news station in Colorado where she is reporting on a car accident where a man was killed. And she says, man, we tried to reach the man who lost his life in this accident, but he was unavailable for comment. What in the world are you talking about? Look, maybe he wasn't available for comment because he was freaking dead.
Maybe.
You get the what the.
So my first what the is going to go out to a unnamed car dealership. So my girlfriend is trying to buy a car at the time, or she bought it yesterday, okay? and we find this nice Nissan Sentra that's listed at just above $9,000. And we get there, we're like, okay, cool. Like we got some money to put down on it, all that good stuff. We show up and we start talking to the guy, and he gives us the total estimate, and it's $13,000. And we're like, what? So we go through all this stuff, and one of the things on there was called the Clorox 360 Zoom. Let me tell you what the Clorox 360 Zoom is. What the Clorox 360 Zoom is, they literally spray your car down to clean it with Clorox, and it cost you $950. That was one of the many payments that we almost had to make. But we were like, oh, nay, nay. So unnamed car dealership. Wyatt
says, I have women who do that for me.
Shut up. Unnamed car dealerships. What the? You terrible ghosts. What the?
And let me whip back into this next what the as Way gives me the name.
Stop it.
Oh, no. So my next what the is going to go out to the sports community world. Like, I know Combs is upset about the Hall of Fame baseball writers and not voting these people into the Hall of Fame, yada, yada, yada. But let's be real. Where are the Cornhole Hall of Fame? I've been watching the ESPN, and these guys are, like, bagging the cornholes, man. It's like swoosh, 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 and, like, I take the cornhole boards out in my backyard, and I'm lucky to hit the board half the time. Guys, what the goes out to the baseball or to the Hall of Fame world? Guys, we need a Cornhole Hall of Fame. Get me some.
My next what the is going out to Buck. Buck, the last two segments, you have mentioned pre-cum and now cornhole. Like, I don't know what is going on with you tonight, buddy, but you need to get your head straight, Buck. You get the what the.
My next what the is one I hold near and dear to my heart on this one. To all of the great fans. No, not great. All the fans out there that didn't even make it to the conference championship game and gave me crap when my Packers lost. Cough, cough, Combs. You get the what the.
All right, so this what the has been building up in me for a couple days here, right? It is just like on a Monday morning when you go take a break and you just let all the stress out from the weekend because you can't go to the bathroom because your boys are in the bathroom, right? So I have a particular coworker that basically she wants my job, right? She wants basically to step up into the big boy world, put on the big boy pants, and take Buck Nasty's job. But let me tell you this, little micromanager engineer girl. So guys, I work in the IT world, and this girl is over my shoulder all the time. Oh, did you do this? Did you? Girl, shut the fuck up. I'm doing what I want to do. I've been doing this a lot longer than you have, so you chill the F out. Listen, Buck knows how to do shit and get shit done. I don't need to take through 15 steps to get to point A to point B. There's no 1A, 2A, B. It's A to B, girl. A to B. And if you want to talk behind my back, put your phone on mute next time so I don't hear you. Come on, man. What the?
My next what the goes out to Wyatt and his Green Bay Packers.
Oh,
Matt LaFleur, what the hell were you doing? You have fourth down. You have the NFL MVP at quarterback. You're down by 8 points, and you kick a field goal with just over 2 minutes to go. You don't try an onside kick, and you give Tom Brady the ball back and say, hey, we don't need to stop you from scoring. We don't need to stop you from kicking a field goal. We only need to stop you from getting a first down, and we're going to do that. Yeah, good luck with that. Great game plan, Matt LaFleur. That's why you guys suck again.
These were not the Bears.
The
What the? What the? What the? What the?
My next what the goes out to the snow, okay? Here in southern Indiana, we are being showered by snow right now, all right? And I came home today, and I was going to do something very nice for my family. So I went out, and with the help of my awesome girlfriend, we shoveled the entire walkway and salted the thing. Do what?
Don't you have cleaning ladies for that?
Shut up. God, I hate you. We shoveled the entire walkway and salted it. And I look outside no less than 10 minutes later, and there's snow all over it. There was so much it compacted over it. Snow. What the?
And my final what the of the night before we bring Big Zen on tonight for the interview, it goes out to Wyatt Williams. Wyatt, everybody knows that it is supposed to snow till 7 o'clock in the morning. Therefore, you wait till the snow is done, and then you go plow the... Come on, man. Come on, Wyatt. What the, man?
What the is going to go out one last time. I'm going to beat a dead horse, and I'm going to talk to the Baseball Writers of America, and I am going to talk to the Major League Baseball. Major League Baseball, you need to take over the Hall of Fame. Baseball Writers of America, you need to get off your high horse. You can let a guy like Ty Cobb in, but you can't let Barry Bonds in because he put a needle in his butt. Give me a damn break. Get off your high horse, stop playing God, and put these guys that belong in the Hall of Fame in the damn Hall of Fame.
I saved my final what the best for last, and I think we all knew this was coming, okay? I think everybody watching this knew what my final what the was going to be. My final what the goes out to Kevin King, okay? I don't even need to explain it. If you watch the NFC Championship, you know exactly what I'm talking about, okay? Exactly. That is what I want to do to Kevin King. I'm telling you, hey, meet me in the Octagon, Kevin King. We will go at this dude, all right?
Oh, my God.
I'm glad he is a free agent at the end of the year. I have not liked him since we wasted a second-round pick on him. Kevin King, you get the eternal, forever, always, infinity of the world, God mode, what the? If that's a thing. God, I hate you, Kevin King.
What the? What the? What the?
What? is up, Man Hour Nation? It is the best interviewer in the world, the Wyatt Williams. And I have a very special guest with me, the former Highlander, the current Buckeye, the Zen Michalski. How are you today, sir?
I'm doing good. How are you guys doing?
Awesome, man. So you just moved into Columbus. You're all by yourself. What's it like living on your own?
Well, it's really cool. I'm not by myself. I have two roommates, and we share a really big apartment, so it's kind of like that. But no, it's awesome. It's so much fun. And been here about since like Saturday, so probably like 4 days now. So no, but no, it's awesome. I love it so far.
So who are your roommates?
It's me, Ben, and Ty Leek. Ty Leek's a defensive tackle, and then Ben's an offensive guard with me. And then we actually have one room left in our four-bedroom apartment that is not filled. It's going to be filled late in the summer somewhere by another guard, Donovan Jackson. He just couldn't move yet or graduate early.
Awesome, man. So, Buck, were you trying to say something?
Yeah, so basically when Wyatt was asking how do you feel about being all by yourself, it was basically like how do you feel not having your mom in your house anymore, not cooking supper, not eating grandma's chili or whatever it was. How does that feel?
That's cool. There's upsides and downsides. I mean, like, I love, like, being on my own. And, like, the food, you know, I still get – it's pretty much home-cooked still, but we get, like, food from the facilities every day, and it's, like, made in front of us by, like, chefs and stuff, and it's that's just really cool. So the food's not going away, but, like, my laundry magically disappearing and reappearing in my room, that luxury's
kind of gone. Hold it all nice and creased and whatnot, yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of gone. But other than that, not too much. I mean, I miss my family, but I'm not that far away, so it's not that big of a deal with me.
How was the drive up?
Oh, not bad at all. It's like all one highway, so it took us, it's like a 3-hour drive, but it probably took us like 2.5 to get here.
Yeah.
So Zen, one of the biggest adjustments for me from like going, so like I graduated high school like May 25th, and by like June 1st, like I was like, so like I had like, you know, basically like a week and a half off from being a high schooler, you know, and then going into like a college athlete. You basically graduated high school and then you were a college athlete. So like you really had no time to adjust. Do you feel like there has been a growth of maturity over the last 3 or 4 days that like you didn't have just like last week?
Oh yeah, I think so for sure. I kind of feel like a lot of the stuff I wouldn't do at home, I've kind of just like picked up really easily here. And like, I just feel like I'm way more comfortable than I thought I was going to be, you know, being on my own, being like, I'm going to take care of my own stuff, do my own laundry, dishes, just, you know, all that. So I love it. I think it's good, and I think that I'm definitely better prepared than I thought I would be.
So, Zen, did you get a chance to take in the football games this past weekend?
Yeah, I did. I didn't get to watch it fully because we had some meetings and practice, but I was hearing you all talk about it while I was sitting in the lobby. But, yeah, it was Tom Brady's the GOAT. What can I say?
Second greatest.
I agree. He is the GOAT, and the Packers lost again, and Aaron Rodgers can't win an NFC title.
Oh, my God.
But who you got in this Super Bowl?
I want to say the Bucks. I really want to see Patrick Mahomes and the Chiefs lose just because they beat my Browns barely off of some crap.
I want to see him lose just because of Buck.
Oh yeah.
So Zen, just out of these three guys here, my team has gone the furthest. So it was Combs, Wyatt, and then Buck. So I mean, clearly you know who is on your side here. But we like to see your growth from week to week here. So like what is some advice for these incoming freshmen? So you have a roommate, you said, coming in this summer. Like, what is some advice for him to like get acclimated as fast as you have?
I think that he will be acclimated. He's a pretty responsible dude. I think that just really just go with the flow. Just don't expect anything really, because there's so much stuff that's happened that I haven't expected. Just like right. You know, just stuff with workouts and all that. To come in with a open mind and be ready to work, pretty much.
What has been your most favorite part about being on your own in your own apartment with roommates? Is it the late night gaming? Is it the, like, what's the most fun you've had since you've been there?
just hanging out with the guys, really, just it's really crazy how fast you can become best friends with some guys that you like never hung out with, never really knew until, like, I'm to know them. We all have a group chat, we text and stuff, but, like, you know, just, like, being in person with people for 4 days, you don't know how, like, close you actually get with your guys. And it's just been really cool to see, you know, everyone finally for the first time in person, being able to hang out, being able to play video games, like you said. Yeah. You know, we're all running Warzone at night, so it's just been really fun.
So, Zen, what are the training facilities up there like?
Oh, my gosh. You know, so our facility is called the Woody. It's named after Woody Hayes. So, like, the first day I got here, we had to go get COVID tested. So that's where we went, and we had food and stuff. But it's insane. Like, we have, like, a couple weight rooms, gaming center, like, a giant cafeteria. It's just – I've never seen anything like that dedicated to, like, a football team and, like, all the people that support us. And just the locker room is insane. I don't know. I could talk about it all night, but it's just very blessed to be able to be in that, like, that facility and just yeah.
One of the coolest things that I saw that you posted, like, online was the Ohio State branded pop shot thing that is like that basketball shooting thing. Dude, guys, this thing had Ohio State all over it. Zen, are you undefeated on the pop shot yet?
Yeah, we were playing a little bit after breakfast. It's actually up in the cafeteria. It's not even in the gaming room. They just have a couple of those around around the facility that, like, if you're just walking, like, man, I want to play mini hoops right now. You just turn to the mini hoop station. But, yeah, we were playing that. It's really cool. I mean, it's everything about it, honestly, just from the weight room to the, like, even the underwater treadmill that I'm probably going to be using tomorrow after we have our physical test. And it's just so cool to me.
So you mentioned the game room, and, like, that's not even in the game. What's the game room like?
Well, it's like a half-court basketball court where we can play pickup, and then there's, like, I guess, like, probably, like, a dozen, like old arcade games, and there's, like, some new ones, like a PS4 and an Xbox, and there's, like, a golfing simulator thing where you, like, stand there and, say, a big projector on the wall, and you just hit golf balls, and
How's your golf game?
It's really cool. I haven't tried it yet. Can't figure out how to work it.
So I saw you were on the quarantine and stuff whenever you first came in. You know, you tested negative and all that stuff, of course. What have the COVID protocols been like? What has that been like, having to quarantine and going through all of the protocols?
Really not too bad. We're allowed to leave. We can go to the store. We can go to the Woody. We can work out in the facility. Really, it hasn't been much. I just want to stay away from, like, the general population and just try to keep our mask on, stay as safe as possible. Like, we already had three of our guys test positive through our first run through, so that was a big hiccup, a little scary, but I think we're good now.
So, Zen, we had Calvin Brown on yesterday, and you know how I always do with you guys. Like, I when you first came on, I asked, you know, who's an NFL player you would like to go up against and all that stuff, quarterback you like to block for. And Wyatt asked him a question and said, Calvin, if you could have any high school player from Southern Indiana come and join you at Kentucky Wesleyan, who would it be? And he actually said you. So really? How does that make you feel, knowing that guys that have played down in that area look at you and say, man, I would really love to have that guy on my team?
That's really cool. I mean, I never coming into high school, I would never have thought anything like that would ever happen. You know, Steven, last year, I kind of just, I never thought I'd have an impact like that on people, but that's really cool. Yeah, it's funny because, like, I always have little, like eighth graders and freshmen and sophomores that are at Floyd right now always, like, DMing me on Instagram, like, asking a million questions. I try to answer as many as possible because it's, like, stuff that I would want to know back then. Right. But, yeah, it's really cool. Really cool.
So, have you had that moment yet where, like, I don't know, you're sitting in a meeting room, you're sitting at a lunch table, you're sitting in a classroom, whatever it may be, and say Justin Fields, Chris Olave, Wyatt Davis, one of those big names, Master Teague, Trey Sermon. Have you had that moment where, like, you look at him, you're like, oh my God, that is Justin Fields? Like, have you had that moment yet? Have you seen any of those guys?
Yeah, I actually worked out with Paris Johnson today. He's an offensive lineman there right now, and he's like a five-star that came in last year, and he's probably going to be playing this next year. So that's pretty cool. Justin's not here. he left Wyatt. I actually got a chance to talk to Wyatt Davis. He's a right guard. He's our right guard, All-American. He's going to go to the combine this year. But, yeah, no, it's really cool just to see guys like that. I'm sure when we start working out, I'll see everybody. But it's mainly just been freshmen have been kind of like moved away from everyone else, kind of just us right now.
So Zen, I have another question here. So, I mean, like, I hate referring back to you myself, but back when I first went to college for like the first time, it was June, right? And there was nobody on campus except for the guys. It was the football team, and we had a great chance to bond and to grow. But after about that 2 weeks, we're kind of like, man, like, we want to go hang out. Like, we want to go see the town. We want to go do this, and this. Do you think you are going to, because, like, right now with the whole isolation thing happening, do you think you are going to get kind of stir-crazy up there, or is there enough to do at Ohio State to, like, kind of keep you occupied while this quarantine thing happens?
Yeah, I think I'll probably be good just because my time is so, like, that's another thing I never really expected. It's just like how much time it really goes into this stuff. But yeah. Like, I don't even know if I would. Gosh, I think my daily life consists of like waking up, going to the woods, working out, eating, homework, sleep. But like, I don't even know if I have a chance to go hang out. But probably at some point I would like to, or go. I went to the city a couple days ago to look around some friends, and it was super cool. But we'll have to see. We're only on day four so far.
There you go.
Yeah, and you say you're only on day four. So heading into it, you probably haven't gotten your equipment or your jersey yet, or maybe you have. But what do you think your feelings are going to be the first time you walk in and see your last name on the back of an Ohio State jersey and the first time you put on that silver helmet?
Gosh, I don't know. It's definitely going to be a crazy feeling just because it still really doesn't feel real. Feels like it's still so crazy that I'm like, that hit me today when I was sitting there eating lunch. I was like, I am a football player at Ohio State, and I'm just like, wow, that's crazy. So I guess that we'll just have to see. I don't know how I'm going to feel. I was seeing that when I saw my name on my locker when we first came in, I was like, holy crap, like, that's my name on an Ohio State locker. So we'll see.
That's awesome.
It'll definitely be exciting.
So I saw the number swap from 55 to 65. What has that process been like? You know, a number change is a big thing for a player. You know, a lot of guys, you know, kind of identify by that number. You know, you were the big 55. How has that process been like, changing numbers, selecting a number, and making sure you pick the right one for you?
It was a little hard. I know some people think that's weird just because, like, it's a number. But, like, if you're a football player, you understand. But, like, it was cool. Just because, like, our left guard already has 55, so I was like, yeah, that's out the window. I'm going to start thinking of something else. And 65 came up, and it just looked right. And when I saw it in my locker, I was like, definitely thought I made the right choice. And later down the road, like, maybe if I'm a junior or senior, or if it opens back up, we'll be taking 55 back out of retirement. And that'll be a cool moment. I know.
So, Zen, when you got to select number 65, this is kind of eye raising to me because there's roughly about 100 kids on a team, so there are numbers that get duplicated, right? So with that being said, since they wouldn't duplicate number 55 for you, that might mean that you might be able to get into that rotation sooner than you think. Have you thought about that any?
I've not, but yeah, that'd be awesome. I'd love to do that. I know that you can duplicate numbers from defense to offense. I know that, like, Chase Young was number two, and so was, like, J.K. Dobbins, and then when they both played at the same time, and it was only because they were on defense and offense. But yeah, I never really think about that until now. But I hope that'd be a blast if I'm on the field at all next year.
Wyatt, take us home, buddy.
Absolutely. So Zen, my final question for you, man. You know it. I always give those goofy questions, man. And so. Oh, you know, eighth grade, still flashing back to that. I'm wondering, you know, we talked about it last week. When is Coach Day still hasn't contacted me? I'm waiting. You know, I've been checking my email every day, refreshing. You know, I've been looking at my, you know, Instagram DMs, anything I can see, or Twitter, and I haven't seen it yet. Have you talked to him at all for me?
I've not. I've seen him a couple of times, though. He just told me to tell Wyatt that he should, you know, prepare for disappointment, that, you know, all that good stuff. So, yeah.
Did he tell you to tell Wyatt to stick to the wheelchair, man, or something like that, or anything?
Yeah. Told me that crutches probably look better, but it's okay.
So, Zen, before we get out of here, we had a couple of a listener chime in, said, Big Z, can't wait to see you play, we will miss you at Floyd Central next year, so.
Thank you, Mr. Pearl. I remember, you know, Mr. Pearl always came up to me after games and, like, you know, just give me, like, a big hug and be like, good job and stuff, and it was always cool. So I'm definitely going to miss that. Awesome.
Zen, as your friend and now a fan, dude, soak everything in. Take every moment because a blink of an eye, you are going to be a senior preparing for the NFL draft. So, I mean, just enjoy the ride, man.
Thank you, Coach Buck. Hey, I'm excited.
Hey. And once the season starts, man, you got three guys here who need tickets to see Ohio State play. So
no, we don't.
We'll be there cheering you on.
I got y'all.
It is a 6 foot over rule, Combs. Sorry, you are not invited.
Shit, I'm out.
All right, Zen. Thanks for joining us, man. You have a great night.
No problem. Y'all too. I'll see you.
Appreciate you, buddy.
See you on Fortnite, son. It's over.
Oh yeah, yes sir. Yes, sir.
Later, bub.
Good luck, man.
All right, guys, that is Zen with our weekly interview, guys. Like, so I don't know, like, if you guys could see that or not, but I see a maturity in Zen from last week until now.
Yep.
Like, he has literally become a young man, like, basically a man, or, like, in a week, like, whether you want to admit it or not. Like,
well, yeah. And it's almost kind of like that situation. I mean, he's out of his mom's house, you know, he's out of his parents' house. You know, not kicked out or anything, but just gone to college now. You know, it's kind of like one of those sink or swim situations. Grow up, or stay a boy like the rest. You know, and he's choosing the smart route. He's very mature. He's going to do awesome things. I am very excited to see what he does.
Yeah, and not to toot my own horn or anything, but I have given Zen an open line of communication to contact us anytime he wants you, if he needs any advice or anything.
Yeah, I didn't bring it up or anything, but I did send Zen a Facebook request that he has not even accepted in like 3 weeks.
He doesn't do Facebook, homie. Jeez, you're so lame.
He's got a Facebook. I friend requested him. What do you mean he doesn't have a Facebook?
If you get on Twitter, follow him on Twitter because that's what all the cool kids do.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah, Twitter. Tweet.
I'm cool.
Tweet, twat. That tick-tock on the Twitter machine. So guys, we're going to be head to a quick little break. On the other side of the break, we're going to talk some NFL free agency. And Combs, this is going to be near and dear to your heart because Allen Robinson is on his way out of Chicago. Guys, all that much more on the Man Hour. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Man Hour, guys. Michael Buckeyes with Brandon Combs and Wyatt Williams. Head over to manhourradio.com and become a member today. As little as $3 a day, you can see some behind-the-scenes footage. You can join us on watch parties and, of course, get all access to all the blogs over there as well. That's manhourradio.com. So, guys, welcome back to the show. We just had a great interview with Zen, a very, very mature young man now. Over a week, he went from a high school kid to a college kid. Yeah, Zen is probably one of the most humblest kids that I think we have had interview, guys. Like,
all these kids, in Southern Indiana, though, I've been extremely impressed by the way they carry themselves and how humble they actually are. Because when you are an athlete of that caliber, and you're told that you're an athlete of that caliber, sometimes it goes to your head. Well, a lot of times it goes to your head.
Right.
And these kids, man, they take it in stride, and it's almost like they're still trying to figure out whether or not they deserve it. And kudos to them, man, because they are amazing. I can't wait to watch Zen at Ohio State. Some of these other kids here, Calvin Brown, who we had on yesterday, was a great interview. They've got a lot of humble people down there in Southern Indiana, man. So kudos to them. Kudos to their families. Kudos to their parents for raising such great young men.
Yeah, so Wyatt, you came to contest this as well. Like Combs, like Zen is still kind of in like awestruck, I think, because like honestly, this all blew up for him within like 6 months. So from the start of football season this year in like August until now, it has been a Division III look, or like what Indiana State's a Division II, I guess. Like,
no, they're D1, but they're FCS, or not FBS.
Okay. So like it went from a low tier Division I to the Ohio State. So, I mean, it has been a wild ride for Zen.
Been crazy. I remember the first day I saw that he got the offer from Indiana State, and I was like, wow, like that's cool, right? And then the next day, it just took a step up and a step up. And then eventually, like, IU, some Big Ten schools called. And then I was like, wow, like, this is starting to get pretty big. Then Louisville called. And then it just kept progressing there. Then he commits to Louisville, you know, and then that was pretty much it. There was silence. And then all of a sudden, Penn State, Florida State, and Ohio State come out of nowhere. And here's the deal. I told him from the second he got the interview, we talked in the parking lot at Floyd Central after a game. I told him, I was like, dude, he was telling me it's like one of the hardest decisions he's ever wanted to make, because, you know, he loves all the people at Louisville, but at the same time, you know, you can't pass up this opportunity. And that's what I told him. I was like, dude, my opinion here from a Louisville fan, you would be stupid if you didn't go play in Columbus, man. And he's like, yeah, I know, that's the way I feel right now. So, but he's incredibly humble. He deserves everything he's gotten because of the transformation body wise, the work he's put in. I mean, when you look at the guy, talking about roids earlier, he looks like he should be on roids, but he's not. He genuinely worked his you-know-what off so hard that he looks like he's on roids. That is incredible to me.
Wyatt, you weren't here last week, but when we interviewed Zen, he was in the office area, yeah. And we saw him do 10 deadlifts, pop, pop, pop. It was probably about 400 pounds.
During a two-minute break.
Yeah, he didn't even it was just like boom, 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 and he's done. He's a very, very strong individual right now. So guys, before we get into some NFL talk, let's talk a little bit more about Zen. Like, from a coaching standpoint, like I got the opportunity to coach Zen, and it's a very, very great opportunity. But like, you guys do not realize like how hard these coaches were trying to get a hold of Zen. Zen was committed to Louisville, and then he was committed to Ohio State. And he said he's 1,000 pits. Like, Ohio State was the school that he wanted to go to the whole time. Alabama consistently called us before practice, during practice, and after practice, trying to get a hold of Zen because Alabama wanted Zen to come to them. Yeah,
it's crazy.
It was consistently probably. They would probably call at least 10 times a week trying to get Zen.
I would just like to thank Zen for not going to Alabama, because there is no way on God's green earth I could ever root for Alabama, even if Zen was going there. So I would just like to thank him for not choosing Alabama.
Right.
Because at least Ohio State, even though I'm not a huge fan of Ohio State, at least they're bearable.
It's easier to root for them than Michigan, right?
For
yes.
Sure.
Oh, yeah. So speaking of easier to root for, I will never root for the Chicago Bears. And Allen Robinson II doesn't really want to root for them either. He is a free agent. coming this season, and all rumors are pointing that he is on his way out of Chicago. Combs, does Allen Robinson II stay in Chicago? And if he doesn't, where should he land?
I see. So Allen Robinson stays in Chicago if he doesn't sign before they get a quarterback. The Bears are going to get a quarterback this offseason, whether it is through a trade, whether it is through free agency, whether it is through the draft. They're going to have a quarterback this season. Now, that's going to determine what Allen Robinson wants to do. Allen Robinson has not been happy, and I wouldn't be happy either. Look, this guy belongs in the Hall of Fame because he's had 1,000-yard receiving years with Mitch Trubisky, and I can't even
Blake
think of the
Bortles,
other guy's name. Blake Bortles.
Yeah. And there's some terrible names.
Yeah, so Allen Robinson should want out of Chicago. Chicago, look, I love my Bears. I will live and die as a Bears fan. That's just who I am. It's what we do when we have hometown teams. I am a Bears fan. I will always be a Bears fan. But this team is a dumpster fire from the ownership all the way down. And then the fact that they gave
the fans too their dumpster fire as well.
Shut your mouth. You give Ryan Pace another season to do God knows what. Like, this guy has not drafted well. He has not done good things. The second that he drafted Mitch Trubisky, he should have been fired. So as soon as you gave Ryan Pace another year, you pretty much told the rest of the guys, yeah, I know we suck, and I know things have not been good. We're not going to do anything to change that. So here we go.
No, I agree with you there on that one. The Bears are completely dysfunctional from the top to the bottom. I know that hurts Combs to say. I love saying it. But, think Allen Robinson's
now,
got it.
Come on, they've got some pieces. I mean, they've got a really good defense, and they do have weapons.
They are the most wasting of – you want to talk about Green Bay wasting Aaron Rodgers' talent? The Bears are the most waste of talent right now in the league, absolutely. They have – an incredible team. They have an awesome wide receiver core. They have an awesome running back in Montgomery. They have a decent offensive line. The defense is a top three defense in the league. They got Khalil Mack, one of the best pass rushers in the league. They have an awesome wide receiver core, the best DB core. I mean, you can't ask for anything more in Chicago. I'll tell you what, I will trade you our entire team in Green Bay just as long as we keep Rodgers. And I bet you right now we would win a Super Bowl with the Bears team. If Aaron Rodgers had the Bears team, Aaron Rodgers would win a Super Bowl without
Aaron
a doubt.
Aaron Rodgers has the Bears team.
So what you're
Aaron
saying
Rodgers
is,
has a really
he does not
good
have
defense.
That defense.
Oh, you.
Aaron Rodgers has. What?
He is a Pro Bowler, man.
The Green Bay Packers were a higher ranked defense this year than the Chicago Bears were.
They were like 32 through 30 all year. They were a horrible run defense. I will trade you our linebackers and our pass rush for your pass rush any day of the week. The only advantage we might have on you is that we might have – not might. I think we have, if not the best, the second best corner in the league in Jair Alexander. The dude is a
Kyle
freak.
Fuller's a beast.
Jair Alexander is definitely better than Kyle Fuller.
I
don't know about that. Kyle Fuller's a beast. He's a very underrated cornerback in this league.
I love Fuller. Yeah. I agree with you. I think he's extremely underrated. I think he's a great corner as well. But if Jalen Ramsey wasn't as good of a fundamental football player as he is with his tackling and all that stuff, then Jair Alexander, in my book, would be the best cornerback in the league. Like, I that might be biased as a Packers fan, but I'm telling you, man, Jair is incredible.
You are being biased because Fuller is probably the best cornerback in the league.
Did Fuller go to the Pro Bowl this year?
If you are going to base stuff off of Pro Bowl, man, you need to be a baseball writer and vote for the Hall of Fame.
No, I'm not basing it all off of that. But I'm just saying, if Fuller is so good, he would have got a nod for the Pro Bowl. He didn't have as many picks as I haven't even looked at the number, but I can guarantee you right now that Fuller, odds are, did not have a better season statistically than Jair Alexander. Because as a straight-up cornerback, Jair Alexander had probably the best season in the league other than Jalen Ramsey, because Ramsey was just locking down guys all year.
Why? Here is the difference between defense and offense. You cannot base a defensive player off of their stats because the offense can basically avoid that guy. Why do you think Darrell Revis's like interceptions were like way down after he became like the island, because teams simply stopped throwing to that side. So you cannot base off of a defensive player off of their stats.
But Jair Alexander,
the eye test.
Jair Alexander, every single time he was thrown to in the playoffs, if a quarterback threw to him on every single tip, he held the quarterbacks to a 0.0 QBR. Tom Brady, he held Tom Brady to a 0.0 QBR when Tom Brady threw to him. Jared Goff, anybody you want to mention that he's played this year, and I think his regular season was like a I'm not sure exactly what it is. I think it's like 30 and below, which is still incredible. I mean,
he's not going up against any wide receivers.
Allen Robinson, Adam Thielen, Kenny Galladay, Marvin Jones.
And who was throwing to Adam Thielen?
Kirk Cousins isn't that bad of a quarterback. Now, Mitch, I'll give you Mitch. But Matthew Stafford
is good
throwing
on Sunday afternoons at 1 o'clock. Any other time, he sucks.
That's only when we played him. We played him at 1 o'clock every single time. We didn't play him any primetime games when he sucks. We played him every and he held all those wide receivers to basically nothing. He stopped
Allen
Robinson.
Now that you turn this into a Packers topic again, where does Allen Robinson go, Wyatt? The Bears.
Allen Robinson goes. I like what Buck said. I think Kansas City is a really good fit for him. He's a guy that could go to any of the 32 teams. Anybody would love him. Here's the deal. Allen Robinson
with Allen Robinson and Tyreek Hill and Travis Kelce.
It's insane. It's literally ridiculous. The only problem I foresee with it is they have used too much cap space to get him in off of the $500 million contract. That would be the only issue I foresee with that. But if he's willing to work it out financially,
who are you speaking of? Patrick Mahomes?
Yes.
Patrick Mahomes' contract is all back end. So like right now, he is only making like $16 million. There is plenty of cap space.
He's backloaded.
His whole contract is backloaded.
Okay, when does the big money hit?
Year six and year seven.
Okay. So then, then that literally frees it up. Then I would say the Chiefs is the best fit because of the cap space I didn't know about. Apparently, they've got enough to get a hold of him now. And look at his quarterbacks he's had. Look at the numbers he's put up with Sunday. I crushed 13 beers, 4 hours, spent the rest of the night between the bathtub and the bathroom floor. Me too, man. Yes. Today is finally my first normal day of
crying. So I feel like we're going to start talking about the Green Bay Packers again. So we're just going to go and catch you off right there, Wyatt. So speaking of cornerbacks, there is a really good cornerback down in Arizona that we haven't spoke of, and Patrick Peterson. He is going to become a free agent as well this season or this off season. But was it a couple years ago when the Kansas City's defense was really looking for that free agent splash. Patrick Peterson and the Kansas City Chiefs name kept coming up in place and place and place. But now he did sign with the Arizona Cardinals for a couple more years. But now he is a free agent. So where do you think Patrick Peterson ends up next year?
Probably in Arizona again. I mean, I know that's kind of like his home, man. I think he loves playing there. Not loves. I think he has his home established there as Patrick Peterson. When you think of him, he is an Arizona Cardinal. He is an Arizona Cardinal legend. He was a part of the DB crew that was great whenever they had Tyrann Mathieu. He was a part of the almost Super Bowl team that was incredible defensively. So he is a great player, and I think that he should definitely stay in Arizona because I think Arizona is a team that is on the rise right now that nobody's talking about. They have a really good young quarterback.
Talk about him.
Huh?
Literally everybody's talking about them.
Not as much as they should be. They didn't make the playoffs. If they would have made the playoffs, mark my words on this, if they'd have made the playoffs, they probably would have won at least a game in the playoffs and went to the divisional round. I really do think so. Because and also he's got Buda Baker there to back him up as well. Chandler Jones isn't bad. Kevin King will sign with Case. Great. Yeah. I don't care, just as long as Kevin King's not in a Green Bay uniform next year, man. That's all I care about. I don't care if he becomes the greatest anywhere else. He's not going to be the greatest in green and gold.
I just proved a point. You can't bring up any comment about Green Bay without this guy going off on a five-minute tangent about Green Bay. So, no, Patrick Peterson.
I'm still salty.
I agree. Patrick Peterson is the epitome of the Arizona Cardinals. He's the face of the Arizona Cardinals defense. However, every once in a while, those faces need to change. Khalil Mack was the face of the Raiders defense until they traded him to the Chicago Bears. And so I think that Patrick Peterson, and I think that this team is going to make a lot of splashes, not just Patrick Peterson, but I think that they are ready to start building around somebody finally. The Cincinnati Bengals is where I think Patrick Peterson goes. I think the Cincinnati Bengals are poised to make a run. I think that they make runs at guys like Juju Smith-Schuster. I think that they make a run at Allen Robinson. And I think that this is a very enticing place for top-name wide receivers and top-name defenders to go to because they really have something in Cincinnati. And you haven't been able to say that for a very, very long time, probably since Boomer Esiason's days. Could you say that Cincinnati really had something? And yep. So I really think that Patrick Peterson going to Cincinnati makes a ton of sense.
Yeah, that does make sense because they do have a top 15 quarterback there in Big Joe Burrow, and then they have a top 5 running back there in Joe Mixon as well, right? But one team that is kind of flying underneath the radar,
oh god,
that has a ton of cap space with the new head coach, Jacksonville Jaguars, guys. This team could go from worst to first if they pick up a receiver or a cornerback in this free agent market, and they got 11 draft picks this year. They have 11 draft picks this year. Let me say that one more time. They have 11 draft picks this year with tons of cap space. They can draft a quarterback. They can pick up a couple receivers in free agency, beef up that defense, and bada bing, bada boom, Jacksonville Jaguars are the talk of the town again. So I think
for 1 year, and then they'll suck again.
But still, the NFL is a win now league. It is not.
Yeah.
I'm going to build for 5 years down the road. I am built to win right now, and let's be honest, that's what Urban Meyer does. He builds for right now, and then leaves a team and leaves it in shambles for 3 years, and he has heart issues. Everyone was on the Arizona hype train. Exactly. Everybody was talking big about them when they beat the Cowboys on Monday Night Football, and then of course we didn't see the Cowboys. What did old Denny Green?
We thought they were.
Well, the Cowboys were not who we thought they were, is what I should say. So,
but see, Jacksonville, you say worst to first, but they're not a team that is going to go worst. I mean, that division is really good. The Indianapolis Colts are going to be the cream of the crop of that division for at least the next 5 years.
But they have all the cap space,
especially if they go out
picks.
and get God damn it. What's his name from Detroit?
Matthew Stafford.
If they go and get Stafford, they go and get a quarterback, that team is a very dominant team in that division.
You're saying the Colts or the Jaguars?
Urban Meyer is not going to get a quarterback in Jacksonville. He is going to get a quarterback in the draft.
He's drafting a quarterback.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the Colts. The Colts are going to be dominant with Matthew Stafford.
Oh, okay.
Not the Jaguars.
I thought he was talking about Jacksonville, too. I was like, Combs, come on, man. They're drafting Trevor Lawrence. Yeah. They're drafting the big TL first overall.
Yeah, and he's going to be a bust, and that's why Jacksonville isn't going to be very good.
The only reason why Trevor Lawrence would be a bust is because of the stuff around him. That would be the only reason why.
And that's why I think the Jacksonville Jaguars hit the free agent market hard this year, because you have receivers like Allen Robinson, Patrick Peterson, like a cornerback out there. And another receiver that comes to mind is Juju Smith-Schuster. He is a free agent in Pittsburgh this year. Combs, was it you that said like the Pittsburgh has like 65% of their roster as free agents this year or something like that?
Yeah.
It's something crazy. But guys, so the question has to be asked, does Juju stay in Pittsburgh, or does Pittsburgh build around that young receiver core that they have? Wyatt?
Another kid headed to Cincinnati. I mean, I think that Cincinnati is a landing spot for a couple of these big-name free agents, and especially for a guy like Juju Smith-Schuster. And for, you know, to get Joe Burrow a weapon like that would be phenomenal. Cincinnati is, I'm telling you right now, they are building something, and they are going to be there within the next 2 to 3 years. They are going to be a legit threat in the AFC.
Doesn't Cincinnati, they drafted, they already have AJ Green, and then they have a T. Higgins, right? So, like, I don't think AJ they need
Green
another.
They have Boyd. I think AJ Green's on the move, but they have Boyd, though. Boyd's a great wide receiver. They have that one tight end. I can't remember his name, though. It is Uzmagoma or something like that, some crazy name. But he's there as well. They're building around the offensive line, so I think that Cincinnati would be a nice stop for him. I don't know. I think after what happened with Pittsburgh this year, I think there's a lot of people that are hitting the road. I'm not 100% sure on Juju just yet, but it would make sense if Juju got out of town. But at the same time, I feel like Pittsburgh loves Juju, even though everything that happened this year, all that stuff. But I think that he's still Corvetting in Pittsburgh next year.
See,
Pittsburgh's
and like,
a complete rebuild, right?
Yeah, I think so. I think they are hitting the reset button 100%, and they're building – and they're going to build around that Irish guy that they have at wide receiver core at Chase Claypool. I mean, they have so this is kind of the Pittsburgh Steelers like MMO, right? I mean, they had Antonio Brown, they drafted Juju surpassed Antonio Brown, and then now Chase Claypool is passing Juju, so now Claypool is going to have his time in the sun for 3 or 4 years, and they're going to draft another guy, and it's just going to keep going up and up and up. So I think Juju is on the move, and I would not be surprised if maybe the Packers make a play for him. I mean, we have heard all of the rumblings that Aaron Rodgers is talking, saying that he wants weapons around him. Why not go after Juju?
Don't,
you could probably get him
from
a good
the Packers. God, all right, go ahead, Wyatt. 10 minutes. Go ahead.
I don't want Juju, man.
You don't want Juju? Why?
I'm not a big Juju fan. I'm not a big guy on his focus. I love his personality. I really do. I enjoy who he is. But I think he needs to focus a lot. And I think that Bengals game was the real eye opener for him when he got thumped. And he came out to his team and was like, "Okay, I'm done dancing." That was kind of the moment where I was like, "Oh yeah, the kid can't really focus on the game." And then at the very end of the year, he kind of, you know, he did the dance again, and then they got killed, you know. And then he talked all this smack about the Browns, and then the Browns showed him what's up. So I like Juju's personality, but I'm not a big guy on his play on the field. So especially this year, I mean, yeah, he had some good moments, and yeah, he struggled a little bit because he was double covered, and that left Claypool open a lot more. But Juju is bad. Yes, that's kind of what I'm leaning out here. I think Juju is bad Juju for sure. I think that he kind of
does. Like another old Beckham Jr. Should.
No, not at all.
No, he's not that bad. No,
you guys, like, the only reason why you are seeing Juju being the bad Juju is because the whole TikTok. And if you listen to my what does. TikTok just needs to get off the face of Earth because it is bad and it's bad.
I've
and
got
it's
a
bad
13-year-old publicity. Stepdaughter that would disagree with you highly.
but if you guys look at Juju's career, he had his best career when he had a other receiver to help take away that threat, aka Antonio Brown. And Antonio Brown was that number one receiver on the Pittsburgh Steelers. Juju was the number two. People were double teaming Antonio, and Juju succeeded. Right, once Antonio left, Juju became the guy, and I think his first year of being the guy, yeah, he still had a Pro Bowl caliber year, but then after that he has gone down. So why wouldn't a team like the Green Bay Packers make perfect sense? You have Adams being your number one receiver, Juju would be your number two. Juju would be Hall of Fame in numbers.
We've got too many guys to build around right now. We still have Marquez Valdez Scantling, who gets a lot of reps. He's a great speedster wide receiver. We still have Alan Lazard, who I think Alan Lazard is going to be a top 10 guy in the league eventually. If Davante Adams wasn't there, I think he'd already be that guy. And then Robert Tonyan. So I think it would just take away from the weapons we already have. If we're going to get a weapon, I'm thinking it's – I wouldn't say weapons. I would say more of kind of in the direction of offensive line help, because we've seen that a lot.
That's a Swiss Army knife.
What?
I said that's not a weapon. That's a Swiss Army knife.
Yeah.
So speaking of weapons,
well, we needed all the protection we needed.
Speaking of weapons and Green Bay, Aaron Jones is a free agent, and after the way he performed in that last game versus the Bucks, I wouldn't see why he wouldn't be out
of
Green Bay
he?
Anyways. He got hurt, but he just I feel like he pulled a Jay Cutler and just didn't want to play because he was preparing himself for his next big contract, and I think that's what Aaron Jones is doing. He has already turned down a top five pay as a running back with the Green Bay Packers. So I think he is looking for that top, that the best money, and the Packers are just not going to give it to him because they're owned by Wyatt. And it just, it is. So guys, do you think Aaron Jones moves on from Green Bay?
Yeah, I think Aaron Jones is one of those guys. We talked about Jacksonville earlier. I think Aaron Jones is one of those guys stopping in Jacksonville to be their running back, along with James Robinson. I think he would add a nice touch. James Robinson is your power back. You know, you don't really – you can throw to James, but you don't really toss it to him around and stuff. And so Aaron Jones adds a nice piece to your offense that you can really toss it to your running back. You can run those check down routes, the screens. He does really well with it. And as for the Packers, I think they are going to move on simply because there's too many guys behind him as well. Jamal Williams is a great running back. We've seen what he can do while – Aaron Jones was out the many times he was this year. A.J. Dillon stepped up big against the Titans. We saw a little taste of what he was. So I think that for sure that both teams are going to both sides are going to part ways, and I think Jacksonville is probably the best landing spot for him, and I think that's where he's going to end up.
And you know, when we talked baseball and free agents, I always said that the Mets were going to make big moves. And I think that the Cincinnati Bengals are the Mets of the NFL. I think they're going to make a lot of big moves. I could really see, can you imagine a two-back system with Joe Mixon and Aaron Jones? I mean, that would be absolutely incredible behind Joe Burrow. And I could really see Aaron Jones fitting in Cincinnati.
The problem with that is Adam Jones is going to want big money. I'm talking Ezekiel Elliott, $100 million money. And I don't think Cincinnati is going to get that.
Cincinnati's already got their receiving back in Geo.
Yeah, but what you want and what you get are two totally different things. I mean,
nobody wants Jones. Nobody wants a high-paid running back.
Exactly.
Right now.
That's what I'm saying. He's going to have to settle for less than what he wants.
I bet you he pulls a Le'Veon Bell. He sits out a year, and then somebody like the Jets is going to give him that top tier money. He's going to flat out suck and end up on the Kansas City Chiefs and go to the Super Bowl, but not ever play.
Okay, Wyatt.
So guys, we are going to take our last break of the show. We've had a pretty eventful show. We had Zen on, talk a little bit of NFL, but the poll question over on the youtube.com/manhour. Is Mahomes versus the Brady the best quarterback matchup ever? The voting's is still open, guys. So head over to manhourradio.com if you missed any part of the show as well. We'll be right back after this break.
That'll bring us to the 2-minute warning.
And welcome back to the Man Hour, guys. Michael Buckeyes along with Brandon Combs and Wyatt Williams. Head over to manhourradio.com. Check out the members tab. You become a member as little as $3 a month. You get all
come
the,
join our OnlyFans.
Our OnlyFans. But Wyatt does keep his clothes on, unlike he does right here. He does not do that over
that
the,
is like, that over is there. Just a taste of the exclusive content you're going to get here from the Man Hour OnlyFans. Okay?
I really hope I never see that picture again. So call
if
me
you look, there's a nip slip on the right side here. It's beautiful.
Yeah. Wow. I just kind of got sick in my mouth a little bit, guys. Wow. I'm speechless. Speaking of speechless, Michigan University is also sportsless. Guys, they have basically canceled the season here, or canceled all sports for the next month because they have basically found a new strand of COVID within the athletic department. It doesn't say what sport or whatever, but I was talking to a football player over there, and he told me that none of the football players have ever tested positive all season. So with that news that I just told you, Combs, that none of the Michigan football players have tested positive all season, when Michigan canceled the game versus Ohio State, do you think they were just trying to hide a down year for Michigan sports in general?
I think it's a down year for Michigan football. I wouldn't say it's a down year for Michigan sports in general. I mean, their basketball team, I believe, is 13-1 right now, ranked fourth in the nation. So they're not. I don't think they're trying to hide that. I mean, they're going to the NCAA tournament. They're going to make a lot of money there. But it was a really bad year for their football team. And I said when it happened, I think that a big part of them canceling that Ohio State game was it's Ohio State, it's their rival, and they were trying to screw them out of an extra game to you know, get into their conference title game, in which the Big Ten said, yeah, we'll screw you, Michigan, because we're not letting you screw anybody. So, no, I wouldn't say that they were trying to hide a down season, but I think it was their reason to not go and play in big games and get embarrassed in big games because they just weren't that good. And then they went and just gave Harbaugh an extension, which boggles my mind.
Big head scratcher, is it? Like, isn't that?
Yeah, I don't understand it at all.
Almost as big as that move the Bears made with Pace.
Almost as big as that move that Matt LaFleur made with 2 minutes to go in the NFC title game.
That took you a while, Combs.
Let's see how far you guys can go back and forth.
Almost.
Game over. Checkmate.
Jesus.
So flashing back to the Michigan sports here, like, so, Combs, you said that the Michigan basketball team is more than likely going to make the NCAA tournament. However, you had to have 7 negative tests to be able to go to the bubble in Indianapolis to play in the tournament. And like, I know here at the high school level, I believe it's a school in Evansville North, they're actually refusing to play varsity basketball games right now just so their varsity team can go play in sectionals and regionals and stuff like that. So yeah. So with that being said, I can say that the Michigan athletic department was trying to probably hide from a down football season 100%, but I am going to jump on your train saying that maybe they're protecting their players for the basketball season, like, a little bit. Maybe. I don't know.
Why? I think that's got to be what it is, because I think football-wise, the whole move for them to not play Ohio State was simply so that they could screw over Ohio State. I mean, that Ohio State Michigan, if not the biggest rivalry in all of sports, it is a top 3 rivalry in all sports. And if Michigan wasn't going to win that game, they knew that. So they went at Ohio State at any rate that they could to get themselves, you know, that leg to where Ohio State couldn't make the tournament either. So I would say that was a football move, but with basketball, I think it's exactly what you said, Buck. I think it's just that, you know, they want to be ready for the tournament because Michigan is one of those teams that Michigan has a real shot at this. They've only got one loss. They play in a really tough division in the Big Ten. They play in a really tough conference. So they're a really good team, and they have a lot of potential to go on and win the overall tournament. So,
what are we going to say, Combs?
I just think that Michigan right now, I think there's a lot of stuff going on. I'm not sure what it is, but there's got to be something big that they're hiding. I almost feel like, you know, when you get a, you know, like a cover-up for something, it's just one of those things. It's just not... It's not sitting the right way, especially when you hear that not one football player tested positive all season long. Then what the hell happened? Because they canceled a whole heck of a lot of games. It wasn't just the Ohio State game.
I mean, at some point you have to think it is political, right? Because their mayor, because my cousins live up there, they have been shut down 100% since March. Like they aren't allowed to go to the grocery store. They aren't allowed to do anything. Just in the last few months, they've started to open back up. So I feel like it's been a real political battle. And if you flash back to, what was it, July, we broke right here on the Man Hour that the Big Ten would be the first conference to say that we aren't playing this year, and that basically came out of the state of Michigan and I believe was Wisconsin as well, saying that, hey, we don't want to be a part of this because of the whole COVID situation.
Yeah. I mean, again, this whole COVID thing is getting out of hand. I can't wait for it to all be over. And then eventually we'll find out what's going on there at Michigan.
It'll eventually pop up no matter what it is.
Yeah, I'll dig a little bit deeper into our sources and see what they say. But speaking of sources here, Wyatt, I saw some breaking news come over the Twitter machine, and basically Aaron Rodgers is asking for a trade, and three teams that came to his list is Chicago Bears, Dallas Cowboys, and Miami Dolphins. What are your thoughts on that?
Not true.
It's on Twitter. Go to ESPN right now and look. What are your first and initial thoughts?
He's looking. Look at him. Look at it. He's like, where? Where is that? I don't see it.
It's not true.
Aaron Rodgers to the Bears, man. Face it.
I'm looking up on ESPN. There.
Yeah. That's it for the Man Hour, guys. Head over to manhourradio.com. Check out the side. Combs, send us out.
Man Hour Nation, rise up.